Dutch EMDR Association has the honor of being the organizer of the 10th EMDR Europe Conference 2009. The organization is pleased that the founder of EMDR, Dr. Francine Shapiro, accepted the invitation to come to the Netherlands for this festive occasion. 20 years ago, Francine Shapiro wrote her now famous first article on EMDR. Since then, EMDR has developed into a psychotherapy recommended as treatment of choice for trauma, but applied to other areas as well. An interview with Francine Shapiro about her brainchild. Francine, a warm, warm welcome to Amsterdam.
Thank you.
And thank you for the opportunity to have this interview together. And I will ask you those questions that everybody always wants to know about. Of course, the first question is, how did you discover EMDR?
Well, it actually started 10 years before the actual discovery, when I got cancer.
Yes.
And that changed my concentration from the work I was doing for a PhD in English literature,
yeah,
and put the concentration on mind and body, because yes, the whole area of psychoneuroimmunology was just beginning to arise. And we were beginning to be aware of the interaction between stress and different disease process. And it seemed very intriguing to me that we were able, as a society, to be so technologically advanced that,
yeah,
we had put a man on the moon, but we still weren't aware of how to deal with the mind and the body issues. So it attracted my attention. And so I started to use my mind and body as a laboratory to explore these different interventions,
okay,
and the different techniques. And I started a nonprofit organization that brought many people together in order to find out also what was available across different disciplines to bring it out to the general public.
That sounds very Francine to me.
And around the time that I needed to be doing a dissertation, one day I was walking along and I noticed that some disturbing thoughts that I was having,
yes,
were suddenly disappearing.
Okay.
And when I went to bring them back, they didn't have the same charge. They weren't as bothersome, but I hadn't done anything deliberately. And I knew that these were the kind of thoughts that you usually had to engage with in a certain way in order to get them to change.
Yeah.
And I noticed that when that kind of thought came through my mind, my eyes very rapidly started moving in,
mm-hmm,
a certain way, very rapid, spontaneous, very rapid saccadic diagonal movement, mm-hmm, up,
yeah,
and down. And I didn't know, hadn't realized that I had ever done that before, but suddenly I noticed that the thought shifted from consciousness,
yeah,
and when I brought it back, it didn't have the same disturbance. So I wanted to see if it would work deliberately. I brought up something,
okay,
that bothered me, moved my eyes in the same way, and so the same thing happened. And I started to play around with that.
Okay.
Then I went to see if it would work with anyone else. And I would engage in a classroom situation and ask classmates or colleagues or other people I knew, what's bothering you?
Okay.
Everyone had something. They brought up something. And then I asked them to move their eyes.
Yeah.
And they weren't able to do it. They didn't have the muscle,
okay,
control. So that's when I used my hand to guide them. And then found that the same thing started to happen. The disturbance would begin to disappear,
yeah,
but then for many people it would stop. And I found I had to add components, different procedures, in order to allow it to continue to give the effect. And those procedures then became the beginning of EMDR.
How did you select what was productive and wasn't?
Well, the expectation was,
yeah,
that it would work with everyone and that there was a certain amount of disturbance that was being removed,
yeah,
each time I did this set,
yes,
of eye movements. Therefore, if it didn't change, I immediately tried something else in order to see if I would add in. So,
okay,
it was a trial and error,
yeah,
over periods of time. where it was an expectation of seeing a change, okay. And if it didn't exist, do something that would allow it. And so it was that experimentation that okay. allowed it to work.
What did you experience when you found out it worked so well?
The beginning work was with people who had various things that bothered them, you know, something at work or something yeah. with a spouse or, you know, but in general, it wasn't people who were suffering intensely. But in moving towards the dissertation, to do the dissertation, and looking to find a group that had a diagnosis yes. that was homogeneous, I decided to work with old memories, and the ones that seemed to have most difficulty with old memories were trauma victims, and the diagnosis of post-traumatic stress disorder had just arrived in the diagnostic manual
yeah.
About 7 years before in 1990. So I decided to concentrate to see if it would work with PTSD people. And I went to a veterans outreach center to see if they would allow me to work with someone who had a major trauma. Yeah. And they did, and it was someone who had been haunted from Vietnam.
Yeah.
With something that had happened to him. And so using the procedure with this person and seeing something that had haunted him for 20 years disappear within a few moments
yeah.
was wonderful. It
yeah.
was wonderful. The flip side was watching all of the TV programs of all of the trauma victims
yeah.
being paraded across after disasters, after
yeah.
wars, after
yeah.
accidents, and realizing that there was something there that I had that could help,
yeah.
and the push to be able to do it, and at that time, not having the ability to have it out there and widespread. So this has always been the flip side of the discovery,
yeah.
how much it can do, and also how much needs to be done at the same time.
How did you develop EMDR from this beginning, and how did you bring it into the world?
Initially, doing a lot of presentations,
okay.
about hundreds of presentations to different psychology groups, the American Psychological Association, every organization I could find to do presentations to show the research that I had done, and people started giving me their cards to say when I was ready to teach it that they wanted to learn. And during that period of time, also developing standards of practice.
Okay.
Of what would work to teach it well. I was teaching individual therapists at that
okay.
time and getting feedback from them of the type of effects that they were getting. And then when those people came and learned it, many of them felt that it had a strong potential and they wanted to make it known. And they went back to their own local communities and organized to sponsor workshops
okay.
there. So I gave many workshops during those first years, many trainings, in order to let it be known as widely as we could.
And many of us therapists were so happy with the results we were seeing for our clients that almost from there there's this dedication to help spread EMDR. Yes.
Well, you see, that's the beauty of certain types of clinicians, because I met many during those first years. And some that would come and say, as you just did, I see the potential and I want other people
yes.
to have it.
Yeah.
I will do what I can to
yeah.
make sure it's widespread.
Yes.
But then there were other clinicians who came and said, I see the potential and I don't want anyone else in my community to do it. I want to be the one to do it. And it was those that
oh.
saw it as an advantage for themselves, really, not for what it could do for others. The beauty of what's happened
yeah.
over all of these years is that clinicians such as you, who really, from their heart,
yeah.
want to
yeah.
see people healed,
yeah.
that these organizations now are in Europe, in Latin America, in the United States, are
yeah.
dedicated to that
yeah.
and being able to bring it out worldwide. That's the beauty. Of it being
yeah.
able to touch hearts such as yours.
Yeah. I think you have changed the lives of many therapists and also of millions of clients all over the world. How does that make you feel when you realize that?
It is the same as it was at the beginning, that it's wonderful in terms of what it can do, and there's also the pain of how much more there is to do, of certain doors that are still closed because of misunderstanding, of ignorance, of criticism based on old information or old misunderstandings. And so, for instance, the fact that EMDR is able to eliminate phantom limb pain, and there are millions of people suffering from it, from war, from accidents, from landmines, from diabetes, from so many different areas. And the amount of suffering that these people are going through in their lifetime, which could be eliminated within 12 sessions, there's a good chance that it would be eliminated. And yet these people are still suffering. This is still very painful for me. So it's always that, again, that two side of the coin, the joy at what it can do and the pain at what it's not being allowed to do.
In the early years of EMDR, you got a lot of negative reactions coming your way. It's like contempt and scorn, and people made fun of you. You were accused of having a sect, and EMDR was an elite thing. And it was about making money, lots of money. And I wondered many times, how did you manage to cope with that?
Well, early on, I discovered those in the spotlight were like a blank screen that people would project themselves onto it. And I knew the reasons I was doing what I was doing, which was client safety.
Yeah.
And believing that people needed to be trained in order to work with clients seemed very obvious to me. So the criticism began because I insisted on trainings and had people sign agreements that this was experimental at the time. It needed to be trained.
Yeah, I remember that time.
Because I found when I didn't have these agreements, I discovered after doing the first two workshops in the United States that clients were getting hurt. There was the clinician I knew who was doing workshops for spouses of abused women. And he recommended EMDR to the group for them and for their wives. And one of the men said to him, "Oh, my wife has had that and it was terrible for her. I would never let her do that." And we investigated and discovered that someone I had trained, a clinician I had trained, had turned around and trained a hypnotist who did not have any clinical background. And that's where the harm was coming from. It wasn't an isolated case. People were teaching those who were not clinicians with no background in their version of it, with not even understanding what they had been taught. So I felt ethically I had to make sure that the clients were protected, and I had people sign agreements. If they wanted to be trained by me, they needed to agree it was experimental and they were not to train others until they were approved to do so. This caused a great uproar within the behavioral community, like this was a domain making or something.
So it was a sect. EMDR was an elite thing, and it was about making money or being important or hard to get, etc.
Yeah, that's what
I'm exclusive.
The blank screen. You know.
So it was research and research from the very first moment of EMDR. Talking of research, a lot of research has been done on outcome. But also there has been quite a lot of research on the process underlying EMDR. And what are the results so far? And especially, what are your own thoughts on this?
That's one place that needs to be done, and it is a sticking point causing the continued criticism.
Okay.
All right? Because the critics have said of EMDR, that it's simply an exposure technique with superfluous eye movements. All right. Mm-hmm. Now, anyone that does EMDR know that neither are true,
mm-hmm. yeah.
because it violates all of the standards that you would need to do for a good exposure yeah. therapy.
Yeah.
And the eye movement, certainly we see the change as soon as we bring in this eye movement or other form of
yes.
bilateral stimulation. But scientifically, the eye movements are not proven. There are at least a dozen studies that have been done in the laboratories mm-hmm. with the eye movement in isolation
okay.
that have shown a decrease in arousal, decrease in vivid imagery, change of emotionality, how it elicits episodic memory, how it changes attentional flexibility. There are so many studies like that that have been shown and that are helping to guide us in understanding of what the underlying basis is, but they are ignored by the critics
mm-hmm.
who want to see definitive studies that show treatment outcome differences. And the problem is that the previous studies that have been done evaluating the effect of the eye movement within
yeah.
the procedure
mm-hmm.
have been done very badly, have used it, for instance, only with combat veterans and tried to judge differences on the basis of after two sessions or after treating only one memory
mm-hmm.
and then wanting to see differences in overall PTSD scores,
yeah.
which you're
yeah.
not going to do, because these are multiply traumatized individuals
yeah.
and to treat only one memory is to taking only one log out of the fire to see the
yeah.
difference. So that wasn't well done. Then other studies that were done, for instance, using only 7 and 8 people in each condition
mm-hmm.
when the
yeah.
good research says, standards say,
yeah.
it must be done with 30 to 35. And so these earlier studies that were done badly are the ones that have essentially poisoned the field to think that the eye movements are superfluous. But it's understandable because the good research was not done. It's important now,
yeah.
very important, that good research studies been done of component analyses of EMDR with and without the eye movement with diagnosed PTSD patients that are with measures, single stressor
mm-hmm.
PTSD patients with appropriate measures that would show symptom differences. Until that's done, the field will continue to say it's superfluous eye movement. And it's up to those who are working with EMDR to do the appropriate
mm-hmm.
research so that it
okay.
answers that question. And then once you determine definitively that the eye movement or other bilateral stimulation makes a difference, then these individual studies to determine what's underlying it are extremely important. Is it the orienting response? Is it working memory? Is it both? Is it because it links into REM sleep or not?
Mm-hmm.
Is there a difference between bilateral and fixed? Is there a difference between eye movement and hand taps and tones? None of these studies have been done.
Now, for a moment, let's forget about the field and let's forget about the results of research. And tell us your own thoughts about this. How do you think EMDR works?
Well, from the beginning, I felt that it links into the processes of REM sleep. It just seemed to make sense that you would be going to sleep, and before you go to sleep, you're worried about something, you're disturbed.
Mm-hmm.
You sleep and wake up having a better understanding of it. And at the very beginning, back in 89, they actually believed that the eye movement had no purpose except for scanning the dream environment, you know. But again, it felt that it was something that made sense. Robert Stickgold's
yep.
analysis of it subsequently, and the new research that emerged saying that, yes, indeed, REM sleep was a time for consolidating, for processing survival information and memory information. So now it makes more sense to the field. And people such as Bob Stickgold are putting the neurobiological underpinnings yeah. into that understanding of it. Yeah. And that's where I think the answers are going to be found. But indeed, since we're also doing it in waking state, I believe it's bringing in more factors as well. I think also when we look at the across the field in terms of what the neurobiological understanding is, the field of cognitive behavior therapy has an information processing model, the FOA, emotional processing model. And it is generally only applied into the anxiety disorders. Mm-hmm. And with that, there's the sense of you have to access the memory network, what they call the fear structure, which of yeah. course makes sense. And then the change occurs because of the incorporation of corrective information, which also makes yeah. sense. And this is what the adaptive information processing model says as well. But where it's separated, you see, is that with the information processing models of CBT, which are working with therapies that are based on an extinction model, mm-hmm. there's the notion that the corrective information is more or less externally induced because you're manipulating the beliefs or you're manipulating the behaviors and keeping the person concentrating on that memory network and not allowing any associations to be made because this is considered in avoidance. And that by keeping the focus on only that memory and showing that the worst expectations do not arise, mm-hmm. that yeah. the corrective information comes in by evaluating one's own behavior and reaction in response to this, as well as the that they're in a safe environment and not going into a panic attack and not dying, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And so they're getting the corrective information that way. EMDR is saying, no, it is because of the connection of the internal memory networks that the changes are being made. That it's the accessing of the target memory network and activating the information processing system, which allows the appropriate connections between the internal memory mm-hmm. networks, allowing the target memory to be assimilated within the larger memory networks. This is where the connective information occurs, not from the observation of the outside reaction, but rather the internal connections. You have new other memories that are coming up that are providing the corrective information. You have the internal insights that are coming up. So what you're doing is taking the target memory that has the image, the thoughts and sounds, the emotions, the physical sensations, the beliefs that were there at the time of the event, which were encoded, and by accessing this and stimulating the information processing system, that memory transmutes along that information processing track as the more adaptive networks are able to link in. And this memory itself, the target memory, is changed. The image changes, the thoughts and sounds, the emotion, physical sensation. What's useful is incorporated within the larger memory networks. What's useless is able to be discarded. And this transformed memory becomes restored in this new adaptive form, where exposure therapies, extinction therapies, are now understood neurobiologically not to change the original memory, but rather to form a new one that competes with it. Yeah. The extinction memory, the original memory, is believed to remain intact in the brain. Yeah. And this would explain the relapse that occurs with exposure yeah. therapy if it's in a situation very similar to the one where they originally were traumatized. I do not believe EMDR works with this process. I believe it works with a process that has now been given the name of reconsolidation, okay. which is that the original memory is changed after it is accessed, and it's restored, it's stored in a new way. And that's why we transformed and stored in a new way. So it's the original memory is altered in EMDR, whereas it is believed with exposure therapy, the original memory is not altered. So when we see research in PTSD that says, well, it has the same effect size of EMDR and exposure, that's because it's measuring only the overt symptoms of how many flashbacks or intrusions or the change of arousal. And also the fact that in most cases you're dealing with an additional 50 hours of homework to achieve those effects. Yeah. But all of the other effects that we see, the personal growth that emerges, the insight, the personality changes, the trait changes that we observe with EMDR, these have not been evaluated. These have not been measured. And so comparing only exposure effect on overt symptoms and EMDR effect on overt symptoms might be the same, even though with exposure it takes so many more homework hours, the other domains have not been affected, have not been evaluated. And so that also needs to be done in research to evaluate the difference between, let's say, exposure therapies and EMDR therapies in terms of relapse rate, insight, personality change, trait change. All of these things would be predicted by the adaptive information processing model to be different because the original memory has been stored differently and is therefore the foundation of a different sense of self, you see?
Yeah.
All right? And so the difference between extinction neurobiologically and reconsolidation neurobiologically is extremely important, and that research needs to be done. So I'm basically saying that when we say, what is the underlying basis of EMDR? It's not going to be only one thing. It's not going to be only one thing for any form of psychotherapy. And we don't know even what's the underlying basis for most forms of pharmaceuticals. Yeah. You see? So we need not to fixate only on the eye movement, because there are many procedures in EMDR other than the eye movement or other form of bilateral stimulation that is having an effect. And there's going to be changes throughout many cortical structures. One of the problems in looking at neurobiology is that it's almost become the new mythology, you know?
Yeah.
That people say, we have to decondition the amygdala. But all we know are pre and post. We know that the amygdala is responding, the limbic system is responding in one way before, and it's responding in another way after. But to say we have to decondition the amygdala is making a statement which is there's no proof of, because the amygdala doesn't have an executive function to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
So to make statements about neurobiology when it's still only in its infancy, you see, can be very reductive. And what we need to do is keep our mind open to all of the new advances that are being made and to try to be as rigorous as possible in looking for the neurobiology, but within the clinical standards that are appropriate. That is, what is the appropriate kind of patient to use for the study?
Yeah.
What are the appropriate measures to use that are going to give us the whole larger picture and not just one little aspect of it? And then maybe within the next 10, 20 years, we'll have a better idea of the neurobiology, because it's just beginning now.
Many times you emphasize that EMDR is not a technique, it's psychotherapy. And why is this distinction so important to you?
Okay. Well, EMD originally was a technique. It was very structured. We would go with the image and the negative belief and continue to return to it after each set of eye movements.
Yeah.
You know, anybody could really master that in a very short period of time. EMDR is quite more than that. So it has to be guided by an understanding that allows it to be customized to each individual. That's the first part.
Mm-hmm.
But the more and the most also significant part is that It's not always applied the same way. It's not applied to only one thing. The critics, again, say EMDR is an atheoretical technique, an atheoretical exposure technique with superfluous eye movement. And this is incorrect all the way through.
It's quite a compliment.
It is incorrect all the way through. It's not a technique. EMDR is a form of psychotherapy. It's on par with psychodynamic therapy and with cognitive behavior therapy because it's a form of treatment that's guided by a distinct information processing model. It is an information processing therapy. Now, information processing, again, is used in cognitive behavior therapy, but primarily for the anxiety disorders. EMDR is used for anxiety disorders and much more. The basis of it as a form of psychotherapy is if you are practicing psychodynamic therapy, the model that is being used is that the treatment is of intrapsychic conflicts. There is the use of transference, and is the working through of these different problems verbally. And this is a structure of psychodynamic therapy that's going to be recognized by anyone looking at it. Cognitive behavior therapy is a form of psychotherapy that is based on the notion that the basis of the pathology are the irrational beliefs and the dysfunctional behaviors, and the treatment is the deliberate manipulation of the beliefs and the behaviors. And this is a form of psychotherapy that is also recognizable by anyone that's doing it. EMDR is a form of psychotherapy guided by the adaptive information processing model that states that the root of the pathology are the dysfunctionally stored memories. The dysfunctionally stored memories are the roots of the pathology. The beliefs, the negative beliefs, are not the cause, they are the symptom. The negative behaviors are not the cause, they are the symptom. We do not use the deliberate manipulation of behaviors and beliefs to make the change. We do not use working through and transference in order to make the change. We use the accessing and processing of these targeted memories to make the change, and the incorporation of other memory experience in order to enhance more towards adaptive resolution. So as an information processing therapy, it is another form of psychology. And to call it a technique is missing the boat. The fact that it is another form of psychology gives a widespread understanding of the entire clinical picture and a widespread understanding of how it can be applied. And it's very important to recognize it for what it is.
By now, has become clear that EMDR is not a therapy for trauma alone, but it can be applied to many other symptoms and other kinds of pathology.
Right.
What are your thoughts and concerns about that?
From the very beginning, in 1990, there was the understanding that it wasn't simply desensitization. When I originally named it as desensitization back in 1988, it was because I came from a behavioral orientation and believed that what we had was a desensitization technique, like systematic desensitization, and that we were doing was simply getting rid of anxiety and fear. And the repetition of going back and back and back was like systematic desensitization, but that the eye movement, I believed, was the relaxation device, the internal relaxation device. Mm-hmm. So it was desensitization. And applying it primarily to trauma came from the fact that that was the first study. Now, I was working with people before then who had problems in these different areas, but again, it was focusing on the anxiety and fear, and that's when you're right in the middle of the anxiety disorders.
Yeah.
But in the very beginning of the trainings, again, starting from 1990, it was describing to people how it could be used for self-esteem issues, how it could be used for the different clinical complaints. But the research that was done over the years was to find to get it accepted by the mainstream field of psychology. And so most of the studies that were done on post-traumatic stress disorder, and that's where the concentration was. Also, to teach the field, I introduced the notion of small T trauma, because people understood that PTSD was caused by an event. And then we could explain this. This event was stored in memory in a certain way, and it was causing the pathology. But also to get across to people that just because something was criterion A, horror and death potential, and therefore could be used for diagnosing PTSD, that there was still, at the basis of pathology, life experiences. And that we could call them small T trauma in order for people to understand that just because it wasn't criterion A, it could still be a trauma and have a long-lasting negative effect on a person. So it was a teaching device to get people to understand. The problem is that some people, or many people, hooked on to that and started thinking of it as only trauma. And so the conversations became of it as trauma. The people who were trained in EMDR understood that small T trauma was a wide area of what it could be applied to, but the rest of the field continued only to hear trauma, and so EMDR then becomes pigeonholed as only trauma. But it's not that at all. And so the way to think about it is general life experiences that are highly disturbing and disrupt that information processing system that we all have, get stored in the brain in a certain way, and it becomes the root of perhaps all pathologies that we're looking at, except those that are caused by genetic factors, by physical insult, damage, or lack of information, that most, or if not all, clinical complaints are either caused or exacerbated by the earlier life experiences that are stored in memory in a dysfunctional form that has not allowed them to link up with anything more adaptive, and that have the image, the thoughts and sounds, the emotion, the physical sense, and the belief that was there at the time. Therefore, the information processing model, the adaptive information processing model, that's the guide to how to apply EMDR as a psychotherapy, says to look at the symptoms and target the memories that are at the basis of it, and the prediction will be, if it is not caused by physical insult, as in phantom limb pain that's being caused not because it's a phantom pain, but because of the neuropathy, because of the actual damage to the nervous system. If the phantom limb pain is there, that is not the physical cause of the nerve damage, it is because of the earlier event that's stored in the brain with the physical sensation. So the prediction of the model is the processing of the earlier events will transform the memory, allow the physical sensation to be discarded, and therefore the physical sensation of the phantom limb pain is going to be eliminated. And this prediction has been supported so far by numbers of researchers that have done clinical trials. What's needed are the randomized controlled studies to give it that. Other forms of using EMDR within personality disorders is recognizing that a personality disorder is a configuration of characteristics, and each of the characteristics is based on the earlier life experiences, which are the memories that are dysfunctionally stored. And so with any personality disorder, you are looking to target the individual memories that are causing these different characteristics. So I feel wonderful about it being applied across the board, because that's its purpose as a form of psychotherapy, to be able to address the clinical picture.
Okay.
I have only one question left, the last question. What are your hopes for the future of EMDR?
We see globally so much violence going on throughout the world, areas of genocidal violence. And what we see so often is that trauma and violence, of course, has a negative impact not only on the culture, on the family, on the individual. Trauma would cause a woman, more often than not, to react with depression and anxiety, while the research also shows that for males, the reaction is one of anger. And with all of the political reasons for turf wars and for all of the political reasons that go and that need to go on, and the inequities of wealth which we have to deal with as a world, there's also looking at what can we do for those individuals in pain, whether because of natural disasters or man-made disasters such as war, to alleviate the suffering, so that instead of the continual reaction of anger, rather than the continual stories of seeing oneself in the pictures of all of the earlier wounds and all of the earlier stories of demeaning behaviors or humiliations that have occurred that keep separating people, to allow the processing of these memories so that people can perhaps begin to see the common denominators between them, that they're not automatically responding in pain and violence, but are able to get to that shared sense of humanity. To be able to allow us to get beyond and below the political intrigue that continues all of this, and again go to the grassroots where EMDR originally started. To have enough clinicians worldwide in every country who are working with their own populations to alleviate this suffering, and to have these clinicians worldwide to understand that they are bonded together by a desire to alleviate suffering, and are using a tool that allows each to be willing to confer with another, and the HAP organizations to know that if one country is in need, other countries are going to come to their aid, to be able to bring the world together in that way. That's the hope, to be able to allow EMDR there worldwide where it's needed, and perhaps to make some inroads in bringing peace together.
Thank you very much for this interview.
You're welcome.
And I would like to tell a story from my part, reacting to what you told us about your hope for the future. I had the honor of being in a EMDR training in the Gaza area, and we were working with the participants, and there was this one young male Palestinian clinician, and he did work with EMDR on his own issues. A cousin of his was killed, and he worked on that. And afterwards, he told us that in the weeks before, he many times thought that he wanted to be a suicide bomber, to do something with his anger and his need for revenge. After the EMDR, he said, "I now have discovered there's better ways to help my people, to help my Palestinian people by being a good therapist." And that touched our heart.
Thank you.
I love you. You know that.